Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel Six Sigma by MBA Mohit Sharma. Today is the fifth video of the series DMAIC. In this video, I will talk about what is a control phase and what is its importance and what all tools that we can use in this control phase. So before we get started, let us quickly see what DMAIC stands for. D stands for define, M stands for measure, A stands for analyze, I stands for improve, and C stands for control. So as we move into the control phase, there are three important things that we need to look at in the control phase. The first one is to monitor the progress on your Y's and X's. So in any process, if you have different statistically significant X's which are controlling your Y, you need to monitor the progress of these X's, and you also need to monitor the progress of Y. We need to measure the new process characteristics, and we need to validate the improvements. So some part of that has been done in the improve phase when we have achieved that improvement mark, but we need to control that improvement in the control phase. The second point is to implement the control and response plan. We need to deploy the process control plan on all the axes, and we need to develop a response plan. Response plans are developed in case we have any issue or problem which comes, or any significant X which starts moving out of control. What is the response to that particular X then? That is what we have to define in the response plan. We need to institutionalize the improvements. We need to develop the procedures. We need to identify the process owners. We need to hand it over the improved process to the operations team. In the control phase, we should ask some questions. So the first question that comes to the person's mind is, why should we monitor? We have improved the process, why should we now monitor this? So it is important that when we have proved in the improve phase, that we have improved the process, we need to effectively monitor so that we can provide assurance, yes, that the process has now improved and it will not go back to the problem state again. So that is why we need to monitor the process. We need to monitor the process till the time the new improvements which are there becomes part of the process. And then what should I monitor is the next question which comes to the mind. Then all significant X's and the project Y we need to monitor. Y is a function of X, that is what we have understood in the beginning of the project. And now we need to control all the significant X's which are impacting the project Y. We also need to monitor the project Y because there could be any other X which might have started impacting the Y with the change of time, but we are not monitoring that X. Then we can go back and check which new X has started impacting the Y. That indication can only be given if you start monitoring the project Y as well. So it is important to monitor both significant X's and Y. So how much data we should collect every day and measure? We need to take statistically validated samples, and based on that we should collect data. The next question that can come to the mind is, how can I detect changes in the process variation and capability? And the answer to that question is, when we are monitoring the vital X's with control charts and we look anything which is going out of control, that is when we can identify the changes in the process variation and the capability. The next question that comes is that what we need to do if anything we detect is changing. We have already created a control plan, so we need to take actions based on that control plan, and we need to investigate for probable special causes. There is a response plan also which you have already created if anything goes out of control. So you need to look at the response plan and take actions. The next question which comes to the mind is, if my process is in control and capable, are my customers still satisfied? For that you need to do a customer survey and check with them. So they are the best people who can tell you that your process is in statistical control and we are happy with the process. If they are still not happy, you have not understood their problem statement in the beginning of the project. So if you have understood the problem statement of the customer in the beginning of the project and you have resolved that problem, then the customer would definitely be happy by the end of the control phase of the project. Another important thing in the control phase in general that I am talking about is the involvement of the quality and the operations in the project lifecycle. In the beginning of the project, in the defined phase, the quality team should be more involved and operations team should only provide certain data and numbers to them. And as we move slowly towards the analyze phase, it is 50-50 contribution by both operations and quality team. And as we move towards the control phase, the quality team's role should fade out and everything or the charge should be taken up by the operations team now, because the process is in control now. The proper handover plan should be made by the quality team, and the project should be handed over back to the operations team. The tools that can be used, the first one is called the control plan. I will give you one small example and explain this control plan. The first step is to identify the process, which process you are working on. Say for example, this is the wire transfer process. Process step is the international wire transfer is the process step. And the metric that we are trying to improve is the break time. Break time of the break that the individual were taking was a significant contributing X to the cycle time of the overall wire transfer process. So we are saying that if we reduce the break time, we will be able to control the overall cycle time of the wire transfer process. The upper specification limit is 15 minutes of break. It should not exceed 15 minutes. Measurement technique or the tool, the team has got a software inbuilt into the systems in which the time is recorded when the break is taken, and that will be the measure or the tool that will capture the data. The sample size should be 100% breaks every day should be monitored, because it is a data which is collected in the system, so it can be easily measured. And then control chart is IMR chart. It all depends on the number of observations that the number of breaks that the team is taking. If they are taking two breaks, X bar R chart for that particular purpose, where the subgroup size is 2 then for each individual. If they are taking only one break in a day, then the IMR chart is to be used. The responsibility is of the process team leader. He has to check all this data and create this IMR chart. And what is the frequency of check and check by columns? So these two are the columns which are suggesting that the process manager has to check after every 15 days that the team leader who has been assigned with this responsibility is fulfilling this responsibility. If there is any breach of this particular thing happens, for example, any person is taking more than 15 minutes of break, on the first breach, the warning would be given. That is the kind of reaction plan that we are creating. On the second breach by the same person, meeting with the manager will happen. And on the third breach, a personal development plan is created, PDP is created, and the person is having a conversation with HR. It means it's a behavioral issue, needs to be addressed. So that is how the reaction plan will support your control plan. The next important tool in the control phase is the control chart. I have detailed videos on control chart. I will attach the links of those videos in the description box for your reference. But in this case, I will quickly explain to you what control chart is to be used in what state. If your data is continuous, if your axis which you are monitoring is a continuous X, then it depends on the subgroup size. If the subgroup size is 1, you will use IMR chart. If the subgroup size is between 2 to 8, you will use X bar R chart, which is X bar and range chart. And if the subgroup size is greater than 8, you will use X bar S chart. I will create one chart in Minitab, which is IMR chart, and rest of the charts are similar. You just need to put the subgroup sizes in their chart types and you can get those charts. If your data is discrete, you need to look at two things: whether the sample size that you are collecting every day is a constant sample size or is it a variable sample size. If it is a constant sample size, then you need to check whether you are monitoring the defects or defectives. If you are monitoring defects, you will use C chart. If you are monitoring defectives, you will use NP chart. And in variable lot size, if you are monitoring defects, you will use U chart. And if you are monitoring defectives, you will use P chart. So I will create P chart and IMR chart for your reference in Minitab. And if you want to learn further about control charts, I will attach the links of my video in the description box for your reference. So I have some data which is continuous data in column C1, which is cycle time data. If I want to see whether this data is statistically in control, I will go to stat, control charts, variable charts for individuals, and IMR chart. Click OK. In the variables column, you enter cycle time and click OK. This is the kind of control chart that you will get. All these data points are lying within these two red lines. It means the process is in statistical control. Any data points going out of these control limits, your process is not in statistical control. You need to investigate then. When your process is in control phase, you should at least keep your process in control phase for 2 to 3 months time before you hand this over back to the operations team. The next is when you are being monitored on defectives and you have sample size variable. See, you can see my sample size is varying in column C3, which is 234, 231, 254 like this. And you are being monitored on defectives, which is in column C2. It's like 12, 13, 14, 12, 12, 13. So these are the number of defective units that I am producing. So for this, I will use a P chart. And the path in Minitab is stat, control charts, attribute charts, and P chart. I will click OK. In variable column, I will enter defectives. And in subgroup size, I will enter total units. And I will click OK. So this is the kind of P chart that I will get. So this chart is for discrete data where I am being monitored on defective units and my sample size is varying. You can see all these data points are within these two control limits, so which proves that the process is in statistical control. So friends, I hope you understood what is the control phase, what is its importance, what are the various questions that you should answer yourself before you get into the control phase, and when quality team should hand the project over to the operations team, what is a control plan and what are the control charts. To keep your improved process or improved state in statistical control, you need to understand the importance of the control phase and you need to work accordingly. So friends, I hope you like this video, and if you really like this video, please give it a thumbs up and share this video with your friends. I will see you in my next upcoming video. Till then, take care. Bye bye.